Hello, Icaro. Hello,
Hello, teacher.
hello.
Hello,
Hey,
teacher.
how are you? Hello, Abelino. Good to see you again.
Hello.
How are you today? Hello, Layla.
Hi, teacher.
Are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
Good. Have you joined my class before, Layla?
Yes, just a few months or a few weeks ago, I think.
Oh, okay. Good. Good to see you again, then. It's just been a while. All right. And who else do we have? Yeah, a lot of people showing up today. Let's start with Adrian.
Yeah,
Hey, how are you? Adrian, how are you?
yeah,
Where are you from?
Mexico.
Mexico, okay, good. Nice to see you.
Nothing.
It's a little noisy from where you are. I don't know if there's some extra noise. But I can hear you. Siraz? Firas,
Firas,
hey, how are you?
Oh, fine, thanks.
Right, nice to see you.
Nice to see you. It's my first class here in Colingo.
Oh, really? Welcome. How did you find out about
Thanks. By one of my friends.
me? Okay, cool. Great, great. A lot of word of mouth. We hear about it. So when you it's the best way to advertise a great thing is by word of mouth. You hear your friend tell you about it, word of mouth. Cool. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too.
And Barberek. Barberek? I don't know how to pronounce the name. Can you hear me? Is your microphone on? Right, so we have, and John is here. Hello.
Hello, teacher.
Nice to see you here today. How are you today?
I am excellent right now.
Great. Wonderful. That's a good adjective. I like to hear that. Okay, and Sun?
Hello. My name is Arvik. I'm from Armenia. So,
Okay.
and here my name is Sun.
Okay, so you want me to call you Sun?
Sorry?
So your name is Armenic, but you want me to call you Sun?
Yeah,
Okay.
it is translated in English as sun.
Oh,
Yeah.
all right, interesting. Good to know.
Thank you.
Welcome. Jonathan. Oh, he's gone. We have Jesse.
Hi, teacher. How are you?
I'm great. Nice to see you again.
Good to see you, teacher.
What's new with you? How's your day?
Good. Yeah, thanks.
Okay. It's a little quiet, so if you can make your microphone a little louder, that would be great. if I can hear you better. Okay, so Barberek, can you hear me? Barberek? I don't know how to say your name. Wissami, are you there? So I have one little note to tell you. There's some crazy weather here. And let me see here. Oh, and it's been, there's like thunderstorms here where I am. I live in Atlanta. My name's Anthony. I live in Atlanta, USA. Right now there's some big thunderstorms and rain, and so I just want to make sure that you know there is a slight chance that my power, my electricity might go away and I won't, and I'll disappear, but hopefully that doesn't happen, but I just want to tell you in advance that there's a possibility of that. So that's my first note. Yes, hopefully not. Okay, so today we are doing a music class, and we're going to focus on an instrument, on a musical instrument. It's a very unique musical instrument. And it's called the theremin, and we're going to learn all about the theremin, or a very small kind of history about the theremin, and we'll listen to it too to see what this instrument sounds like. It's a new instrument. It's only been around for less than 100 years, so whereas things like the violin has been around for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. So. And also, we will be working on our second conditional. So our grammar today will be the second conditional. And a good way to say, a good way to think about second conditional is like, if I had only taken more classes in English, maybe I would be better at English. So if I had something, that's like second conditional. So if I won the lottery, I would buy a couple houses. So that would be those are second conditional. Good. So let's begin. Let's talk about the second conditional. And let's first do some warm up here. I'm going to ask you some questions. This is actually going to tie in the future. This this guy who invented this instrument was born in 1896. So let's see if you can use the second conditional before we even learn about it. Let's see if you can try to use the second conditional when I ask you, what would you do if you had been born in 1896? Anyone have a want to give a make a sentence?
Can you explain where? Can you explain where?
Okay.
Depends.
How about your country? In your country.
If I had born in 1896, I was in the middle age, maybe. No, not in the middle age, but in the 19th century, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep. Okay, so if you were born in 1896, then you were born in the 19th century. That's true.
Teacher, if I was born in the 1896, I think I won't be here by Colingo.
Good.
I wouldn't be here by Colingo.
Very good. Very good. Those are both good sentences. Those are both good. Except you don't need an article before the year, so we could just say if I was born in 1896, you don't need to say the 1896. You just say 1896, unless you say the 19th century. But yeah, those are both good, and that's how second conditional sounds. We talk about if, and it's usually means something that is unlikely, not probably not very possible. Like, it's not possible for me to be born in 1896. But let's say, if you had been born, that's how we use that case. And now the famous second conditional question. Anyone can answer this. What would you do if you had $1 million?
So.
I would start my own company.
Oh, okay. So start with the word if and put it into second conditional.
So if I had $1 million, I would start my own company and make more millions of dollars.
Aha, okay. Yes, because in order to start a company, you need money. That's true. What kind of company would you start, Tamayla? Yeah.
I don't know. I didn't have the exactly idea yet, but maybe an accountant company is what I work.
Okay, because that's what you do. Okay, that's right. All right, good. That's a good idea. If you start a company with this money, then you'll make even more money instead of just buying things with it. It's an investment. What else?
Teacher, if I had a $1 million, I would be everywhere around the world. I would be traveling.
Okay.
Traveling in Europe, in the to the USA, everywhere.
And
I also would buy me a big car, a big scooter, a big house. I would have my personal teacher in my house, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And
tutor.
Yes, kind of that.
Oh wow, you have it all figured out. You have all your plans made in case you win. In case you have $1 million, travel the world, cars and houses, tutor,
yes.
Private. All right, good, very good. Anyone else?
For me, if I had $1 million, I would continue my study in Germany or USA.
Okay. So we have another person who would travel, but you travel for a study and not for...
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And so are you also learning German?
I didn't understand.
Did you say you would travel to maybe Germany or USA?
Oh, yes. Germany or USA.
And
to continue my study.
Okay. And are you learning the German language?
No, but... In the next few months, I have to choose between USA and Germany to continue my study with medicine.
Oh, okay, in medicine. Oh, okay. All right. I see. Good.
Hi.
Mm-hmm. Does everyone have
Can I give?
Yeah. Yes. Go ahead. Karim?
If I had $1 million, I would go to Las Vegas to bet, for example.
So you'd gamble the money? You'd go to Las Vegas and you'd bet?
Yeah.
All right. Okay, all sorts of different things. So these are if I had this, of course. Let's move on to some pronunciation techniques here. We're going to talk about past tense. And I used to teach a lot of pronunciation classes in Colingo. We're changing that now, where the pronunciation will be inside the other classes, right? So we won't have pronunciation class anymore. We're going to have, for instance, this is music class, and we'll teach pronunciation inside the class. So I want to talk about the ED ending, which I talk about a lot in my pronunciation classes. It's not easy. It's not an easy thing, and it's a common mistake for English learners to mispronounce these words. Now, there are three ways to pronounce this, and it can be different depending on the spelling. So, for instance, the past tense of laugh, let's say laugh, is, I'd say, it's this word here, of course. How is that pronounced?
Laughed.
Yeah. Good. Yeah, laughed. So, laughed. Exactly, laughed. Not laughed, not laughed, but laughed. So it's one syllable. And then we have one that's slightly different. This word here also ends with the same spelling, but it has a little bit different sound.
Loved.
Loved. Right, loved. So there's
loved.
Yeah, so laughed and loved, and they have a different, kind of a different consonant sound at the end, right? And finally, what about this word that I just
wanted?
So this time, right? This time we actually pronounce the ed wanted, wanted, and
wanted.
Yeah. So there's three ways to pronounce it. Very good. Good. And so one thing, sometimes I have I hear students pronouncing other words with that last IHD, that id sound, wanted. So sometimes people might accidentally make a mistake, and they might say loved, right, or laughed. And so we just have to remember, there's a couple rules that we're going to go through, and the difference. So for instance, the trick is that we add a syllable only when the word ends with a T or a D, right? Like want, so wanted. Or what about the word fade that ends with a D, so it'd be faded.
Fade.
So fade. If it ends with a T or ends with a D.
Teacher.
Yeah.
I'm going to tip a verb. It's this one. How do you pronounce that?
Okay, so we have a word that ends with a G sound. G. Now here's the rule. So we have, if it ends with a T or a D, then it's id. If it ends with a soft sound like a f or a zh, then it's more of a T sound. If it has a buzzing sound like j, like
can you sound. Could you please give us an example?
So that we say aged.
Aged.
So aged wine or aged cheese, or he's aged very well. So it's not a T sound; it's more of a D sound here. Okay, so that's the rule.
Because I just read a part of the of some article. To pronounce it, it must end with I and D. So that will that would be aged, something
aged.
Like that.
Yeah,
aged.
No, it's just aged.
Aged.
One syllable. Right. The only time we pronounce the ed is when it ends with a d, or when the original word, not the final word, but the original. So the root word is age.
Aged.
Right. That ends with a j sound. If it ends with a j sound, we do aged. If it ended with a d, like add, that ends with a d. So we say added, right?
Teacher, what about ask?
Okay, so if it has a hard consonant like that, then it's just like a T sound, asked. I asked him. Yeah.
Is there a rule?
Yeah, the rule is basically, usually the rule for ED words is if it has a soft sound like a f or a s, or if it has a hard sound like k, then we add a T. If it has a buzzing sound like v or z or zh, then it's usually a D, right? And then if it has, we'll look more about this later, and then if it ends in a D or a T, then it has an id. So like sedated. So if it has a breathy sound, right? So like laugh is breathy. So if it's a breathy sound. So that's a T sound, laughed. If it has a buzzy sound, like love, loved, with the D.
What's the rule for drink?
The word drink?
Dream.
Drink.
What word? Can you choose
dream.
Dream?
I'm talking dream.
Drink? Dream. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, that's an irregular verb. So, actually, you could say both. There's two ways you could say. There's
it's not drink.
Both are words. They're both words. So dreamed or dreamt, but they're pronounced differently. Dreamed is pronounced with a D sound, and dreamt is just like it's spelled. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. So. Let's look at. I'm going to give you guys a word. I'm going to type a word, and I want you to tell me how many syllables it has. Even if you don't know the word, try to think of the rules that we just went over and see if you can figure out how many syllables are in the word. So, I just typed in a word there.
Two syllables.
Two, I think.
Mesh, just one?
Just one?
Yes.
One syllable.
One syllable, right.
One syllable, yes.
Right. Okay, good. What about this word?
Again, one. Save.
One syllable.
Right, save.
Just one syllable.
That's correct. Good.
Saved.
Very good. Okay, what I got one more for you. Let's see.
Again, one. Hunt.
One.
Oh, sorry. I meant to say.
Hunted. Two. In that case, two.
Right. Hunt is present tense, but I meant the past tense. Okay, yeah, two syllables. So that's the rule. I think you guys have it pretty well understood. Okay, maybe we'll go back to that later if we have time. Before we learn about the theremin, I want to teach more about the second conditional. So we talked about before, like, if I had $1 million, right, that's the typical, use. So I'm going to type some more things into the chat here. And I would like, Avelino?
Yes?
Could you read that for me, what I just typed in there?
It's used specifically for extremely unlikely situations. If my subject Sarah Day, my simple past subject would, based from verb, if you won the lottery, I would buy a big house. Note, you can use was for the third person. Even though rear is technically correct. If Jenny rear was famous, she would travel around the world.
Okay. Good. So that's one rule here. Let's talk about. So there's another second. Grammatically? Good. Let's talk to Firas.
The the other second conditional form, I would buy a jet if I had 1 million subjects plus wood plus basic from verb plus if plus subject plus verb. Mary would be bored if she went to Mars. They would be happy if they owned a pizza shop. A pizza shop.
Right. So so sometimes you say if I had this or if I were to do this or if I was born him. You could start it with saying you can start with the subject. So that's another construction. And then finally, what about the question form? I'll type one more thing in here. Icaro?
Yes, Richard.
Could you read what I just typed in there?
Okay. If more subject, more simple past, more what would you do? Or if more subject, more simple past, more would you? Example one. If you won the lottery, what would you do? Example two. If you married Brad Pitt, would you be happy?
Mm-hmm. Now let's try to remember our pronunciation rules for today. What about that last sentence again? Try to pronounce that one more time. That. How many syllables do we have in Icaro?
Married?
Married?
I think just one. Married.
Well, I just heard three. You just used three syllables. You said married.
Married.
So we have an R, so it's definitely not going to be three. But yeah, married. Married. So we only say the ed if it ends in a T or a D. Right, so
fasted
on Ramadan, fasted. Okay, so good. Let's talk about the theremin. I promised we'd talk about the theremin. It'd be interesting. We're gonna read an article here.
Yes, because when I read the topic, I was interested. What is the theremin?
Yeah, it's a unique instrument. It's very different. So here we are. This is
an old one.
Oh yeah, it's been around for almost 100 years.
Oh.
And we'll even see a video of this guy. His name is Theremin. That's his name.
Oh.
We're gonna watch him playing it back in the 1920s, long time ago. Very technical.
Okay.
Okay. So listen closely and let me know if there are any vocabulary words that you have a question about or anything else. Theremin, a brief background. The history of the theremin reads like a bestseller international intrigue novel. And if my opinion counts for anything, I think it should be made into a big string extravaganza directed by Ron Howard or even Steven Spielberg. But I digress. It's an undisputed fact that the only musical instrument you play without touching was invented by a Russian engineer extraordinaire named Lev Sergeyevich Theremin, better known and around the world as Leon Theremin. He invented many different devices, but it is the instrument that bears his name that has assured his memory in the collective minds of musicians, engineers, and trivia lovers the world over. Mr. Theremin strived to create a serious classical music instrument that could be played by anyone. Significant work towards this goal occurred in New York during the 1920s. Theremin's disappearance off the streets of New York City, not to be seen or heard from nearly 5 decades, is truly stuff of legend. Whisked away by the KGB, Theremin spent his remaining days after a stay in Siberia as an inventor for the state, a prolific yet unnamed Soviet cog. Check out the documentary Theremin, An Electronic Odyssey, or Albert Glinsky's book Theremin, Ether, Music, and Espionage. Both are excellent sources for Theremin on the fascinating story of Leon Theremin and his groundbreaking inventions. To Theremin's chagrin, his instrument has been used as the premier sound effects box for science fiction and horror movies. It's become synonymous with space aliens, weird phenomena, creatures, and suspense. An integral part of the scores for The Day the Earth Stood Still, The Bride of Frankenstein, Forbidden Planet, Ed Wood, Mars Attacks, and countless other films, it continues to be the go-to instrument of entire genres of filmmaking. Brian Wilson immortalized the theremin sound in the Beach Boys hit Good Vibrations. Think about it. You know that sound. You can add this add to this incredible legacy with your own theremin creations today if you were to play one, because, of course, they are still available in this world. So that's a little bit about the theremin, the instrument. But it's hard to understand about the instrument unless we see it being played, unless we hear it. Because, I mean, how do we know what it looks like, what it sounds like, right? So we can watch a video about it. By the way, if you guys had a problem reading the text, I can share the actual article with you so you can read it again sometime if you like. So let's see. First of all, before we, I'm going to show a video about it, but before we do that, do you, does anyone have a question about that article? Or any questions about the words? Or about the subject matter or the vocabulary or anything?
What does undisputed mean?
Excuse me?
Undisputed.
Oh, undisputed. Okay, so let's type that in here. So, undisputed. So dispute, the word dispute is the root, dispute. And that is like...
To argue.
Right, to argue, exactly, to argue. So, if what does the prefix un mean? What is the prefix? So, un usually means not, right?
It's like with... Not arguing.
Yeah, not. So undisputed means not possible to argue with. You can't argue that theremin. What is it? You can't argue that the theremin is the only musical instrument you play without touching. There's no other one, so you can't argue. It's undisputed. It's an undisputed fact.
Okay. Go on.
Is two way.
Excuse me?
This...
Oh, whisked away.
This phrase...
Ah, okay, to whisk away. So that's a... it's like an informal word. It's kind of like a phrasal verb. So first of all, the word whisk is like when you're... it's like used in cooking. And if you're making eggs and you're beating eggs, like whisk, you can use a whisk and whisk the eggs. If you're making food or baking a cake or something, you whisk the eggs. But whisked away means like swept away very fast, and very quickly to be swept away somewhere. So that's whisked away. If you're taken away somewhere very almost secretly in this sense. So.
Strive. Then.
Strive.
Strive. Yes.
Strive. Strive. So if you strive for...
Go quickly now.
What's that?
Go quickly. It's a regular verb, no?
No, to strive means to try to reach a goal or try very hard, you can strive. So you're trying very hard. You strive to learn English. I'm striving to learn English means I'm trying really, really hard, striving.
Like struggle or something.
Yeah.
Kind of, yeah. Yep. Yeah.
Okay. Right.
Excuse me.
Yes, Ling Ling. Oh,
yeah.
Hi.
I have a question. Hi. I just posted the sentence on lobby. So,
yeah.
What does mean of this sentence?
So, Okay, so whisked away, we learned about, is being taken away by somebody. Yeah. The KGB is a Russian, it's the Russian, like
abbreviation?
Like they're like police, but they're more like governmental police that they try to spy on the people, and they send people to Siberia.
Like FBI?
Kind of like the FBI, yeah, but even more scary or something like that. KGB.
Just because it's Russian,
and it sounded like KGB.
Just like Russian spam.
Uh-huh. And so he spent his days inventing for the state. So that means he was forced to be a government worker. So for the state, and here this the state means the country, the government.
And probably fic is mean...
prolific. What's prolific. That?
Oh, sorry.
So prolific means if you... So if he was a prolific inventor, that means he invented many, many, many things. Lots of new inventions. If I'm a prolific musician, that means I write hundreds of songs. It means I'm prolific. So if you have a lot of output, if you make a lot of things, if you're a painter, you paint hundreds and hundreds of paintings. So prolific means you have a lot of, do a lot of work and a lot of output.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
May I ask?
Just like...
Okay.
Prolific is just like fruitful or lush.
Fruitful.
Yeah.
Fruitful.
Yeah. Okay. Got it. Thanks. Yeah.
Okay. What word, Icaro?
The last word that you are talking about.
Oh, it's in the thing that Ling Ling's posted. Prolific.
Cool.
If you see how it's spelled. If you look at the middle, and look at the world, it looks kind of like word. It looks kind of like pro, like which means it's like a positive. And lif comes from life, so you're able to give a lot, make a lot of things born. So you're making lots of life, and your life is your work. So he's prolific. So he makes lots of inventions. Good. Lots of new vocabulary here.
Something? I mostly pay attention to the pronunciation, so I wanted to ask, to term means chagrin, and it sounded like chagrin, pronouncing.
Yes,
right?
That's correct.
Like sorrow.
Like sorrow, like what?
Sorrow. Sorrow.
Sorrow?
Sadness, sorrow.
Chagrin. Oh, the meaning. So yeah, the pronunciation is correct, and the meaning is like... kind of like sorrow. It's definitely negative. It's like more like they don't like it. They don't like it.
Okay.
Yeah. It's like much to their dismay or to their, you know, they're not happy about it.
So absent.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, good. So, so that was our article. I want to watch this video though too, because it's kind of cool.
I have a last question about this word. How to pronounce it?
Okay, synonymous.
Synonymous. Okay, thanks.
Oh, synonymous means it means the same thing. You think of one thing and you think of the
synonymous.
Synonymous.
Okay. Like anonymous.
Yeah, like anonymous, synonymous. They rhyme. Okay, here we have Leon Theremin playing his own instrument. So I'm just going to play it through the speakers on my computer. So if you'll just mute your microphones, we're going to listen to this short video and check it out. He's going to speak in Russian for a little bit, and then he's going to play it.
Музыкальный инструмент Терминвокс – это первый инструмент такого типа. Это пищево-голосовой инструмент. В нем управление мелодией достигается посредством влияния на электромагнитное поле около инструмента.
Thank you.
It was really amazing. Okay. He was playing without touching the instrument.
Yeah, that's how it works. That's real. It's not a joke.
Like a magic.
It is like magic, exactly.
Yeah.
And that's really how it works. It's really what it looks like, and it's really how it works. It's not a joke. I've seen it used before. It's like the box, uh-huh. And it has two antennas, two like wires. There's one here, there's one here. And so how it works is depending on the distance that your hand...
And maybe the direction?
And maybe the direction. I don't play a theremin. I don't own a theremin. But so one wire talks about the note that's played, right? So guitar here. So one instrument. So one wire talks about like the note. So it'd be. So it might be depending on where mm-hmm. you're, how close you are to, and then the other wire, so you have both, that you're doing both. The other wire talks about how loud it is. It looks like, you could see there the way he's moving both of his hands.
Mm-hmm.
The other one might be.
Yeah.
So that's dynamics and see, you know, so that way you can make, and that's how you make music beautiful.
Yes, he is controlling in a very, very good way.
Right, dynamic.
And it sounds just like the violin sound, right?
Violin?
Yeah, it does sound like a violin. He plays, because he does this, you see he's doing this with his hand?
Mm-hmm.
That creates a vibrato. So for instance, without vibrato, I can sing a note. La. If I sing in that note with vibrato, I'd sing la. That's vibrato, and so it has a vibration, and so he can do that with the depending on how he moves his hand. If he just holds his hand like this, it'll sound la and won't move. La, right? So that's how it works.
I don't think if this instrument exists today or not.
Oh, yes, absolutely. Yeah, it does. It's just not very popular, but it definitely exists. There's many theremin players. Go on YouTube and type in theremin. You'll find millions of interesting videos of people nowadays playing theremin to popular songs or doing interesting things with theremin.
Maybe in operas or something.
I think that can be used in opera. The device.
It is. It has been used in opera. It has, in classical and opera. Mm-hmm.
And does it have its own sound, or it's just like an other instrument sound?
Oh, okay. Good. That's a good question. Now, some electronics are used to make to replicate a sound, but the theremin makes its own sound. This sound is coming from a sine wave. There's a tone that comes from the instrument, and you're controlling that sound with your hands. So it's a new sound. It sounds similar. We had Ikaro said it sounds like a woman's voice. Somebody else said it sounded like a violin. So you can compare it to that. It sounds a little like a violin. It sounds a little like a woman's voice because of
it's
how.
It's like a soprano.
Like a soprano.
Like a woman voice.
Yeah, kind of.
Nice.
Yeah, so that's one way to describe it. You can define it that way. But it has its own sound. It makes its own sound. There was never anything that sounded like that before, exactly. So that's the theremin. Yes, not any woman I know, yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe a robot woman. maybe you've seen some old American science fiction movies that use this sound. Layla said it was sad. Well, the song was very sad. So you can play happy music. I need to do this. Okay. So, let me find. Okay, let's try something here. Okay, so, all right, so just to make sure that you know that this theremin can make happy sounds, and maybe you still don't like it, but I want to play one more song. This is, they talk about this in the article. This is a song by the Beach Boys called Good Vibrations. You may have heard it before.
I love the colorful clothes you wear and the way the sunlight plays upon her head. I hear the sound of what you're drumming on the wind that makes her perfume through the air. I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me excitations. I'm backing up good vibrations. She's giving me excitations. I'm getting good vibrations. I'm getting
Okay, we don't have time to listen to the whole song, but I want to just play, you may have heard that song before, and that has a, there's this kind of vibration in the background.
The theremin.
And that's that, so. But yeah, it's a great song, it's a classic Beach Boys song, and they talk about Brian Wilson in the article because he's one of the Beach Boys. So maybe it's hard to hear, it might be hard to hear in that song, but if you listen to it again later, you can hear it in the background, it's theremin in the chorus. Okay, so, but yeah, not everyone likes this instrument because it's, it does have a strange sound. You don't have to like it. So I want to do some discussion here. I'm going to ask you some questions and try, okay, remember we talked about the second conditional, right? Like if I had $1 million. So let me ask you some questions about this article. And if you can answer me using the second conditional, let's try that. So, how about, would you buy on eBay an original theremin from 1920?
Yes, I would buy it, the theremin. Because I think it is a cool device. I would buy it.
Okay. So, what if... What's that, Leila?
I definitely wouldn't buy one.
Okay. Can somebody use the second... Yes, yes.
If I had a chance to play this instrument, only in that case I will buy.
Ah, okay. Good. Good job. So, that's using the second...
Not just for... A souvenir.
No, okay. Good use of second conditional. Very good. So, she would only buy it if she had, if she knew how
to play. A chance to play. A
chance to play it. Yeah. So, Ling Ling, the question was theremin, like the topic of today. So, okay, let's talk about, let's ask another question here. So let's say that you are a musician and say you compose music, and maybe some, there might be some here that do. If you compose music, would you ever write a song that included this instrument, that included the theremin, and try to use the second conditional?
Will you repeat, please, the question?
Right. If you were a music composer, if you wrote music, would you ever write music for the theremin? Would you ever include the theremin?
Yes, if I was a musician, I wouldn't write something for this instrument.
Okay, good.
Is it right, just like this?
Yeah, that you can say that. If I was a musician, I would not write music for this instrument. That's good.
If I was a music composer, I would mix the song with something like Pink Floyd, I think this.
Oh, okay. All right.
Something more psychedelic.
More psychedelic? Okay. Yeah, definitely.
Yes.
It can definitely be psychedelic, and I'm sure some psychedelic bands have probably used the theremin in their music.
If you yes.
If I were composing a song, I would mix the song with the instrument, maybe, for the theremin.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so possibly, maybe. Good. Okay, here's an interesting one. Try to use your creativity here. This will be a hard one, maybe. Let's see. Let's try to use your creativity. What new instrument would you like to invent? If you could invent a new instrument, what would it be?
That is a hard question.
That's a hard question. I know. You have to use creativity. You have to be, because there's a lot of different instruments already. Try to imagine a brand new instrument. How did this guy think of this? You know, he invented a brand new instrument. So, what would you invent?
Maybe something between piano and the guitar, because the guitar is so sweet. The guitar is so hard, and piano so sweet.
Did you say piano and guitar? Did you say guitar? What did you say?
Something between they.
Between piano and what other instrument?
Guitar.
Can you type it for me? Because I'm not sure if I understand. Guitar. Okay, guitar. Yeah, guitar.
Guitar.
Yeah. So okay, mixing them. Okay, that might be interesting. And you,
piano is so sweet and the guitar is so. Strong and sometimes happy.
Yeah, okay. All right.
Teacher,
mm-hmm.
I will invent a combination between a piano and a DJ game, you know? A DJ, somebody.
Oh yeah, so like a piano that also can do like mixing and
at the same time with the DJ play.
Okay.
You know,
cool.
That is a good device.
All right. Yeah. When you know what? When I was a little kid, I have a story about this. When I was a little kid, for about 2 years, there was a toy that I wanted so badly. And it wasn't a toy, it was a little keyboard. It was like a electric keyboard, like this big, small keyboard. And on it, it was all plastic, and it had this circle here, which made a mixing sound, like a ch-ch-ch-ch. And so you could play the piano and make the, and like also like do this whoosh-whoosh-whoosh, like on the same instrument as a toy. And I really wanted it when I was a little kid, but I never got it for Christmas. That's my story. I would like that too. Okay, so okay. One more question for you. So they talked in the beginning of the article about his life was so interesting. Leon Theremin, right? His life was very interesting. Maybe it'd be good for a movie. So if you were to make a movie about Leon Theremin, who would you cast to play him? What actor would you cast to play Leon Theremin?
Maybe Brad Pitt.
Okay, put that in second condition.
If I written a movie for Theremin's life, I would cast Brad Pitt to make him.
Great. Perfect. Excellent. I like it. All right, maybe Brad Pitt would be a good Leon Theremin. You got to train him to do a Russian accent. All right. Okay. All right. Any other ideas. Okay. So,
yes, I would choose Rose Byrne to play piano. It's just like her personality and her talent in her movement.
Who?
Rose Byrne.
Could you type it? Because I can't quite understand. I can't quite hear you.
Yes. Just a second.
No problem. Rose Byrne.
Rose Byrne, yes, Rose Byrne.
That is. Australian. All right. Well, Leon Thurman was a guy, was a man, so but maybe she could be in the movie somehow. Uh-huh. Oh, okay. I see. Yeah, she's in some famous movies, but I haven't seen
Anthony, mm-hmm. How should I start the phrase? What should I say?
Which, the one, like the one you just said?
Yes.
Yeah, you can use, the way you said it was fine. There's other ways you could say it. You could usually start with if, but you could say, or you could start with the, you could start with I would cast.
I said if I risen. Mm-hmm. Is this correct?
That's okay. If I had written, or if I were to write, if I had written a movie, or if I wrote a movie. Yeah. So it's either if I had written or if I wrote. Either one.
Okay.
Or you could start saying I would cast Brad Pitt as my lead actor if I wrote a movie about Leon Thurman. So you can switch it around like that. Okay, so we are almost out of time, but I wanted to just chat with you. I think some of you heard about the new Colingo, which is coming soon. And you may have heard that we've changed the date of the new Colingo. And originally we were going to start it on Monday, but now we're going to give you an extra week, so you can still come to all our classes as regular classes here for another 10 days until we start the new Colingo.
Nice.
It means it will start on 25th of
the
20th July.
22nd.
22nd, okay.
Yeah.
So there will be a time for practice, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just to try.
How it works? Sorry.
Yeah, you can have a trial, I believe. I think they're offering a 1 week free trial to check it out to see if you like it. You can sign
and $40 for each month.
For the first 3 months, I have a coupon for you for $40. Yep. For other people that don't know about the coupon, it's $80. But for you, it's $40 for the new system, and it's gonna be pretty nice. So
yes, but for each month, right?
Only for 3 months for each month. So
okay.
So you save $120 from the first 3 months, and then everyone, if you like.
Okay.
So that's how it works. Okay, I'm out of time now. Thanks everyone for joining me, and have a great weekend. Good job, and I'll hopefully see you soon.
Wish you a good time too.
Bye
bye.
Bye, teacher.
See you soon.
All right, take care.
Bye.